Hello everyone, I'm Captain Logan, and welcome once again to the vast and ominous comic book vault. It's time for new acquisitions, and today I have a whopping 13 books to review for you. The end of February is always a huge week for comics because it's a short month, and so there were a whole lot of things that kind of backloaded for comics this time. Although, interestingly, I have actually a lot fewer DC and Marvel books this week than normal. I have a lot of IDW stuff. I have actually several independent things to review, at least two or three independents, and like I said, not as many DC and Marvel. So I'm going to start right away with the DC and Marvel stuff. First of all, I want to say thanks as always to Elite Comics in Overland Park, Kansas for helping me out with the show, and if you're ever in the Kansas City area, be sure to check out Elite Comics. It's a fantastic store. I really like them, and like I said, I always really appreciate them for what they do for us here on Geekvolution. Let me go ahead and jump right into it, and I'm going to try to go a little bit more rapid fire this week because I have so many books, and I read these, I have to admit, over a spattering of a few days, so bear with me because a couple of these I'm gonna have to kind of refresh myself on because I'm a little bit late getting this up, and some of these I read on Wednesday or Thursday. So anyway, let me go ahead and jump right into it with Origin 2, number 3, which is a series that I at first kind of didn't really understand what the point of it was, why it was coming out. It seemed like it was just kind of milking a name, and the art seemed kind of neat in the first issue, and I liked the atmosphere a lot, but there wasn't a lot of story yet. It was mostly just Wolverine kind of wandering around being an animal and trying to find that balance between being an animal and a man. Really at the beginning, he was actually ignoring the man part entirely. And then the second issue introduced some characters for the series and gave us Essex and brought Sabretooth back into the mix. But I still am now kind of not exactly sure how this is more Origin so much as just the story that happens kind of right after Origin, or not too much time has passed. And anyway, so now on issue 3, and I'm much more understanding where this is going. I'm feeling like more story is being told. I'm enjoying it more. I really kind of liked this issue, and this is by Kieran Gillen with art by Adam Kubert. And I also like Kubert's art more this issue than I did last issue. It's not real splashy. It's not real. It's not real in your face. Hey, look, it's Origin. It's this big, huge deal event. It's kind. It's a little bit more. Understated than that, but anyway, story-wise, we've got a Wolverine at a circus. Now he's being thrown in a cage and being shown off at a circus, and he's refusing to cooperate. So barbarically, the people running the circus and Sabretooth is there. He's part of this. Keep shocking him into submission to force his claws to come out. Meanwhile, the circus is actually losing money because people don't believe that Wolverine is the real deal. They think that it's a gimmick and that they're making it up, and so it's actually hurting the business. And so Essex shows up and offers to help out the circus by doing experiments on Wolverine and proving that he is actually the real deal. And of course, Essex has a huge ulterior motive, which is basically to just dissect Wolverine and learn as much as he can about him. There's a whole lot of stuff in this about still, of course, the man versus the monster. There's in the animal, but interestingly, now bringing Essex deeper into the mix, there's a lot more stuff about whether Essex is more of a monster, more of an animal than Wolverine is, because the idea is, if you experiment on a creature like this that's actually really a man, but you just kind of dehumanize him and pretend like he's not really a man, even if Wolverine himself would prefer to be an animal, which one of you does that make more of the animal? Which one of you is more of a barbarian? And so there's some mad science stuff going on here. And it's a little bit gruesome in places, the experimentation. But overall, I was actually really really more intrigued by this issue, and I'm more interested to see where it's going. It feels less predictable now. I'm not sure exactly where it's going, and the experimentation stuff is interesting. Next up, Uncanny Avengers number 17, one of the most baffling and perplexing comics I've read in a while. Uncanny Avengers has continued to push the envelope of what are they going to be able to get away with and stick. We've been killing off multiple characters. We've been doing this Ragnarok thing where it looks more and more like the actual Earth is going to be destroyed, but of course they can't do that, can they? Can they? I don't want to tell you what happens at the end of this, but it's mind-bending. I don't understand how in the world the entire Marvel Universe is not affected by this book, because it would affect everything. It's crazy. So, like, I don't see how this book is in a bubble. I don't know what's going on. I have to assume that there will be some sort of reversal of all of this. But I expected it to happen in this issue. This was supposed to officially be the end of this arc. And now after this, we're going on to some kind of a Planet X thing. And I guess the whole buildup of the Apocalypse twins trying to create a place for mutants to go, a new planet where they can separate themselves from humans, is actually maybe gonna happen. And so it looks like it's gonna be a while if any of this stuff gets reversed. But like I said, we're killing off major characters right and left in this. We're changing the status quo like crazy. And so I have no idea what ends up sticking in this, or how in the world this could even be happening simultaneously with any of the other Marvel books. I every time I read this book, I feel like I'm missing something, and I trust Remender, and I'm really excited to find out exactly what that ultimately ends up being. And I'm hoping that it's not too gimmicky of a reversal when it finally, inevitably, I think, has to happen. So anyway, this is mostly a bunch of really epic action, and we're getting toward the Ragnarok. We're getting toward the end of that, and we're kind of bringing the whole Marvel Universe into this. And so we've got still a bunch of stuff with Thor fighting the Apocalypse twins, and this really has kind of become Thor's story. I really like where he gets to in this. I really like the conflictedness of Thor. I really like how hard this is for him. He's triumphantly battling these guys, trying to save the Earth, but then at the same time, there's a part of it that is kind of his fault from his past, and so there's a huge theme of the past coming back to haunt you in this. We've had that for a while, and that all kind of comes to fruition here. This book, I've said before, it kind of lost me at some point, and I've been having a really hard time getting back into it. I enjoy it each time I read it, but I don't feel fully present. I don't feel fully engrossed in it, because I just feel like there's always a little bit too much going on. It's a really tough book to read month to month, and also this particular story has just been going on a lot longer than I expected it to. And so anyway, this is one of those things where I imagine, kind of like AVX, it's going to read a lot better altogether. And that's about all I have to say about it. It's unpredictable. I mean, that's the best thing I can say about it, is it doesn't go where you think it's going to, and it's incredibly dark and depressing. I get to the end of this, and I'm like, really, that's how this arc ends? You'd never expect it, because you wouldn't think it was possible. And that's really interesting. And next up, we've got Guardians of the Galaxy number 12, part 4 of the Trial of Jean Grey. This, of course, by Brian Michael Bendis, with art by Sarah Pacelli and Stuart Immonen. This continues to be pretty decompressed. This continues to be a story that I feel could have been either told in fewer issues, or just kind of been more interesting. Maybe that's going to sound harsh to some people. I kind of feel like I'm still seeing a lot of setup in this, 4 issues into it. There are so many characters that Bendis feels like he has to give screen time, that I still feel like we're in the middle of preamble. There's still a lot of setup. There's still a lot of introducing the players in this. From a cliffhanger from the end of last issue, now we've got the Starjammers in this, and we've got we've got Scott Summers from the past, meeting his father again, and we're having to go through all that again. And that's a nice and touching scene, and I'm glad that we have that. It's just, it still feels like a whole lot of buildup. This seems more so far of like a tour of space for the all-new X-Men than it really does the Trial of Jean Grey. It's all kind of setting up the trial. But finally, we do get a little bit of courtroom drama at the end of this. Finally, the trial does kind of start. But it's in like the last 3 or 4 pages. And so I'm kind of expecting the ball to finally get going, and this thing to finally start picking up pace in the last 2 issues of this. I enjoyed this issue, don't get me wrong. All of those interpersonal relationships and things are interesting, and I can certainly empathize with Bendis for having to juggle all of that and wanting all of the space stuff to be in here. I also like that we're kind of paralleling Scott and his father's relationship a little bit with Star-Lord and his father's, and the kind of comparison and contrast there, the Guardians keep getting in the way of Star-Lord's father, and that's driving him crazy, and it's making it hard for the kind of inner galactic tribunal or whatever to really, not tribunal, but I guess just kind of organization of worlds to kind of do their thing. And so yeah, you know, there's some fun to be had in this. As always, I really like Bendis's dialogue, but not a ton of story being told still yet in this. Art is fine as always. That's about all I have to say about it. I will say I do feel for Jean Grey in this. There's still of course the big through for this is, does she really deserve to be going on trial because it wasn't actually her who became the Phoenix, because she hasn't done that yet. So all of that is interesting, but I want to start exploring it more rather than just continually mentioning it. The next one is a really interesting issue of Dark Knight. Dark Knight number 28. This is by Greg Hurwitz and art by Ethan Van Sciver. I'm not looking forward to this series ending. I keep hearing that this is supposed to get the axe here pretty soon. I don't know if it's after this arc or the one, or if there's one after it. I haven't looked into it, but anyway, I really like Hurwitz's writing with Batman. I'm gonna miss him on this book. At the same time, he is somewhat hit and miss here and there, and this is a perfect example. This is an issue that has a lot of really great ideas. I really like what he's doing with this. I like the new spin he's doing with Man-Bat, but it's just too heavy-handed. What he does with this is he brings in yet another new Man-Bat. It seems like every time you see Man-Bat, it's got to be somebody else who's not the original Man-Bat. What is his name? Kirk Langstrom. And in this, we have this really interesting kind of mirrored relationship, this parallel thing of Bruce and his deceased father, and Kirk Langstrom and his father. And we find out that the Langstroms knew each other and were rivals. They're both multi-billionaires. And Kirk Langstrom's father, and it's interesting too, because as far as I know, this is a new kind of made-up thing. I didn't know that Langstrom's that Langstrom had this like really rich father. But it makes sense. I could totally see it. Maybe that's how he got his funding in the first place. And what we find out here is that Kirk's father and Bruce Wayne's father were rivals, and the elder Langstrom always wished that his son was more like Bruce Wayne. When he met Bruce Wayne, he saw a kid who was really driven, really focused, really hardened, and he wanted his son to be like that. And by contrast, you've got Langstrom, Kirk Langstrom, who was focused on what his father felt like were the wrong things, where he's not obsessed with owning the world like his father is. He's not trying to amass power and wealth. He's just interested in science and in learning what he can about science. And the whole Man-Bat thing, of course, was kind of an accident, and it became an obsession for him on accident. Well, what Langstrom's father does in this is, it turns out that he has been taking the Man-Bat formula, and it's a thrill ride thing for him because he feels like he's accomplished everything he can accomplish in life, and he's kind of seen and done everything, and so he's now got to go to the supernatural to find that thrill. And I think that's really interesting. Also, his kind of perception of the world, his kind of Lex Luthor sort of mantra of only the strongest survive, kind of separates him away from Batman. So he and now Bruce Wayne, though he doesn't know it, are kind of foils for each other. And it's because Bruce Wayne has kind of become, I don't want to say that Bruce Wayne is just like his father, but he is, in that he's more altruistic, and he is a billionaire, but he spends all of his time trying to in a certain way give back, though nobody knows it because they don't know that he's Batman, right? And so now you have So you have kind of the rival father's thing playing out, so that like the son has somewhat become the father on one end, but then the other son didn't grow up and become like his father, and so it's all involved. It's interesting. I like it. I like the themes. I like the parallels. It's a comic that made me think. I like all of that. But the problem is everything I just described to you is completely spelled out in dialogue, and it drives me bonkers. Alfred is talking a lot about Bruce Wayne's father and the difference between him and Langstrom, and the difference between Bruce Wayne and the difference between Batman and Man-Bat. Like everything I could glean from what this story is doing is also spelled out in said story. It's like it's analyzing itself and it's interpreting itself, and I found that really distracting because I felt like it wasn't giving the reader enough credit. I felt like all of that was embedded already in the story, and it didn't need to tell me what I was supposed to take from it. So, good story, overwritten story. And that's about what I've got to say about that. Next up, Lois Lane, number one. This is a one-shot, and this is something I didn't expect anything from. I thought I'd try this on a whim, and this is by a writer I'm unfamiliar with, Marguerite Bennett. This is a female writer, and pencils by four different people. And here are the names here on the cover. This is really interesting in that whenever I see a kind of oversized issue like this about one character, I always expect, because this is what's usually done now, like four or five or six different little mini stories about that character. I don't expect a full-blown story that is actually like a $5 story. It's actually like 30, 40 pages. This is that, and I was really impressed by that. This is actually simply a story that takes up too many pages, and would have been weird to, I don't think we do two-issue miniseries anymore. That's a thing that's been done, but I haven't seen that in recent years, really. And so we get a full-blown story here, because this would have been hard to stretch out into three or four issues, but it works great for one shot. I really liked this and was very surprised that I did. This is very literary. I would like to see more writing from Bennett. I think she's fantastic, and what she does with Lois Lane here is gives us this kind of supernatural crime drama with a plot about a drug cartel, or what we think is a drug cartel, that's after Lois's sister Lucy for stealing a supernatural drug. And I don't want to tell you what the drug does. I want to encourage people to read this because, I really liked it, and that's part of the mystery, so I don't want to give that away. But there is a drug. It does have some supernatural properties to it. That's where the that's where the more comic booky supernatural stuff comes in this. And the themes that the book deals with about nostalgia, the issue is called Nostalgia, and about trying to play a role that you're not really up for, that's not really you at the core. There's a lot of themes about how those two things kind of in conjunction can really screw up things for you and kind of mess up your life. And that's all played out with the drug, which is really kind of cool. And so there are these flashbacks about Lucy and Lois, where we learn a lot about her family, and we learn a lot about the relationship between the two sisters. A lot of great details there. It really fleshes them out and makes them come alive. They have their own language that they speak together, that is basically a bunch of different words from different languages that they've picked up on army bases, which I think is really cool. And they've kind of developed their own code that they speak in, and nobody else can understand them. And that really kind of binds them together. And Lois's mother in the past gets a terrible illness and dies, and Lois is kind of forced to take care of her sister and kind of play that motherly role. And that's where the kind of kind of a being, having to be something you're not kind of motif plays in. And like I said, then that's paralleled later with the present day story. Anyway, we get to see Lois Lane do a lot of investigative reporting. We get to see her really be proactive and try to solve a mystery, which is really great and engaging. I really like the way that the flashbacks are very, I think, sophisticatedly and kind of strategically placed, and where they fit and why. It's a little bit Arrow, it's a little bit Lost, and it works. And that's all I'm going to say about it. As far as the story goes, also to say that Superman is barely present at all in the story. This is a Lois Lane story, and that gives it a really different kind of atmosphere that kind of sets it apart from most Superman stories. And I kind of expected to not enjoy this very much just because Superman and Lois Lane aren't an item anymore. I keep finding myself, and I'm not reading a lot of current Superman outside of Supergirl, so I keep kind of wondering what the point is even of Lois Lane right now. And then I read this, and I was like, oh, well, but she's her own character. This is a pretty good argument for maybe a Lois Lane miniseries or an ongoing. I really like the way the supernatural stuff fits in without taking over. It's really kind of background, and like it becomes, you know, by the end of this, what's effectively the third act of this story, it certainly becomes more and more important, but it's not abrasive. It doesn't take over. And the art-wise, it's a little bit jarring in places because it's drawn by four different people, and you can always tell where there's a new artist. It works really well with the flashbacks because I think there's one artist doing the flashbacks. I'm not naming the artist just because I don't know them, but except for one. I do recognize Neves, but that's about it. Anyway, so besides the flashbacks, though, there are some places where the art is kind of jumpy, and I guess they just thought that they needed more artists because this was a bigger story. Anyway, really nice to see some more female blood, writing-wise, and like I said, the writing is really, really good. I want to see more of her in the future, and it's kind of nice to see a really good standalone Lois Lane story, and it's nice to see one of these thick one-shots be a full-blown story, and it's a nice one-and-done short story. You don't need to know anything to read it. And it takes the time it needs to tell a story. It doesn't feel truncated. Very impressed with this. Okay, next up, I don't have a lot to say about this. I'm going to go into some independent books now. Black Science number 4. I feel like Remender isn't getting a ton of story done in each of these issues individually, and I'm not complaining about that, but it does kind of make it difficult to review them individually. I read the first three together, and that made it a little bit easier to talk about the series, but I feel like what he's having to do with this is it is an ensemble cast. Like there is a main character, I think Grant, the scientist who created this this kind of interdimensional teleporter. But and he's got a family, and then they have you know technicians and people who work on the project, and so there are a lot of characters in this. There are people to flesh out. A lot of this particular issue is action, some pretty brutal action in the first half, where they're still in this place they were at the end of issue 3, where they're in another dimension, and they are in the middle of suddenly this war zone. Oh no, what do we do? And so they're trying to basically just survive, and a lot of this is kind of survival, just trying to keep themselves alive until the next jump, because their machine isn't working right, and they can't toggle it to go where they want to when they want to. They have to just wait for it to go to turn on and send them to some other random place next. And so finally they go to another random place after this, but some of them get split off from each other, and so it's going to be interesting to see how they get back together and what they do with all of that. So anyway, like I said, I don't have a lot to say about this issue. I'm still really, really, really liking this series. It's quite good. The art is growing on me more and more, and I do really encourage people to read this, but certainly start at the beginning. Next up, Pariah number 1 from Dark Horse Comics. I didn't know about this. I had no expectations for this. Whenever new number 1s come out for independent books that aren't superhero, I'm doing my level best to try new things and to encourage people to support independent books and try stuff that aren't the big two, or try stuff that aren't just based on TV shows and things that you like. And especially when it's science fiction stuff, I like to give it a try. Because I, as I've always said, I'm more of a superhero guy when it comes to sequential art, but I also am a sci-fi buff, and I love good science fiction storytelling. And this, my friends, is definitely that. Really, really enjoyed this first issue of Pariah. This is by Philip Gallant, and art by Brett Weldeal, and this is created by Aaron Warner and is co-plotted by him. Basically what this is I'm assuming a future Earth. It's kind of interesting because we're so isolated, I don't know a lot about Earth itself, so this is a little bit difficult to talk about, but the idea is that you have this kind of oppressive society on Earth. And there are these rebels that have left, and they're on this space station. And there is somebody that that joined them who has decided to turn himself in, and has caused all kinds of problems for them because of that. It's a space drama, and so they're on the space station, and the space station has been rigged to crash into the Earth by the society that is angry with these rebels, and the rebels are surprised that their oppressors think that they're even enough of a force to do this to them. And so there's a lot of mystery built up about what exactly is going on Earth, about what this relationship is between the two. And again, we don't really know enough about Earth or this supposedly oppressive society to even know what exactly it is that they're so angry about. Do we have a dictator? Do we have just like a single despot? Like what exactly is it? Why do these people feel like they don't have enough freedom? And I think it's very interesting to open a comic book like this and have the entire thing take place on a space station. So far, we've not been to Earth at all, and all we have to go on is what we've been told by our characters, some of who could potentially be unreliable narrators. I don't know. And it's a really great space opera so far, where we get to see these people who don't fully wholly like each other having to work together in order to survive. There's a lot of science in this. There's a lot of discussion about how the stuff works on the space station, and it's all technical, but it's interesting because it's constantly tempered by human beings, I think, seeming to act like people. And I really enjoyed this. I certainly want to read more. I was certainly intrigued, and I thought that Gallant did a really good job of jumping us right into the story without having to explain too much right up front. Without he's a master at exposition in dialogue, and I felt like I was thrown right into this with the rest of these characters. The first two or three pages, I don't really know what I'm reading, but very quickly I'm thrown into it, and I get it, and I understand, and I'm engaged, and I love that kind of storytelling. That's how you do in Medus Res. You don't have to do the gimmick of you start, you know, several minutes into the thing and then you backtrack. This doesn't do that. It does throw us right into the action, and I feel like I'm right there with these characters, and so I really enjoyed that about it. Art is really interesting in this book, and it wasn't too distracting for me. I'm not in love with it. It's not really my kind of thing, and I think it's okay for this. I mean, I think it's fitting this material, but it's not really my thing. Basically, it's really pencil-y, it's really sketchy, and it's the kind of art where the colors kind of move away from the lines a little bit, almost like a kid not quite staying in the lines coloring. And it's really glowy, like the color, everything. I guess it's supposed to be kind of a lighting effect, where like the way light hits things, everything is really kind of glowy. So I'm not as impressed with the art in this. It as I am the story. I mean, it definitely has its own unique aesthetic, and it will probably grow on me. But man, I really, really enjoyed this story. Quite good stuff. Next up, real quick, Hacktivist issue 2. I'm still reading this. This is by Alyssa Milano with art by Colin Kelly, and I'm sorry, I'm sorry, no. With art by Marcus Toe. I forgot about that. And the art is, one, by the way, one of the reasons to read this book. The art is marvelous in this. It's co-written by two different people. It's created by Alyssa Milano, but it's written by Jackson Lansing and Colin Kelly. This is a political thriller through and through. We've got deceit, we've got manipulation, we've got backstabbing. Basically, this issue is all about these the two men that have created this social network that they are using as a front company in order to go into other countries and start revolutions. They are kind of turning on each other a little bit, one more than the other one, but he doesn't realize it yet. And like I said, there's some double crossing going on in this. And they both want different things, and that's kind of messing with their relationship pretty hard, and it's also messing with the entire operation. One of them wants to just do the social network. He thinks that this is really good for the country and for potentially the world at large, and that needs to be their focus in helping people find each other and through on the internet to efficiently find work, find companionship, all that kind of stuff. And the other one is using that as a means to an end. It is a kind of value ethics versus means justifies the ends kind of a relationship. And one is, of course, a master manipulator. At one point, he's referred to as Magneto. I thought that was really interesting because he does sort of have that philosophy a little bit. And it looks like his end game, if I'm reading this right, it looks like it's implying a little bit that ultimately the idea might be to start a revolution in America and to overthrow the American government. I don't know if that's really where it's going, but it looks like that might be, and I think that's really interesting. Anyway, this is a very heavy political book, and it's fun and it's engaging, and it's not one of those things where it's too close to home, so I have a hard time reading it. It is certainly about a lot of current kind of things, but it's also a little bit futuristic. And it's certainly not exactly the world that we're living in. But like I said, it is really politically heavy, and it's one of those books where every now and again there's some things that just kind of go over my head a little bit because I'm not a real political person. So I know somebody like Dan Torrey would probably love this book more than I do, but I'm still reading it because like I said, I find it certainly exciting and engaging. And that's about all I have to say about it. But yeah, if you haven't started this yet and you like political thriller, I think this is a really, really smart one, and I would definitely encourage you to try it out. Okay, let's jump on IDW now. This is a weird week. 5 IDW books. Let's get started. First of all, Powerpuff Girls number 6. This is written and illustrated by Stuart Little and continues to be really, really hilarious. Don't have a lot to say about this one. It's pretty much just a big battle between Mojo Jojo and the Powerpuff Girls, which with lots of clever banter and fun hilarity all the way through it. Basically, this is the end of the first big arc. I thought this was a mini series. I thought it was announced as a miniseries, and I'm still wondering if it ultimately is going to cap off after, you know, 10 or 11 issues or something, or if they just decided at some point, you know what, people are buying this, let's keep going with it. And I hope that's the case. I hope it keeps going because I like it a lot. But anyway, this is the end of this first arc where the citizens, or not the citizens, the villains of Townsville were good guys there for a minute because of him, and then they he let his brainwashing go to try to prove to the Powerpuff Girls that bad people can't change. And there's some really interesting stuff in the issue prior to this, hinting a little bit that might not be wholly true, especially in the case of Fuzzy Lumpkins. Well, here we are finally kind of finishing off where we started with Mojo Jojo, bookending it, where in the first issue Mojo Jojo had gotten Antidote X and had decided to just become Jojo again and go back to work as Professor Utonium's lab assistant. And it turns out that this was all a big, crazy, elaborate scheme in order to destroy Townsville. Mojo Jojo has decided, by the way, that now he doesn't want to rule Townsville, he wants to destroy it. And that, and I always love that kind of thing. I always love the kind of ambiguity of, does a villain want to destroy the world, or does he want to take it over? That kind of thing has always cracked me up, because you get a lot of villains where you can't, they are so two-dimensional, they're so stereotypical, that all they are evil, and their motivations aren't even fully clear. And so here he makes a huge distinction about that, and I think that's fun. So Mojo Jojo becomes, Jojo becomes Mojo Jojo again in this finally, and it turns out that becoming the lab monkey was just the first part of a much larger plan. So anyway, it's a whole lot of fun, and there's also a lot of stuff set up in this to be paid off in the future. I really enjoy the idea of an ongoing Powerpuff narrative where there is some larger, long-term storytelling. I think that's a really cool idea. Okay, my next book. What? Serenity number 2 already? The first issue of this came out last week. For whatever reason, they decided to put the second issue out this week. I haven't looked into stuff. I have no idea how that ended up happening. It might be because of that weird February thing. I have no idea. But anyway, so this is Serenity Leaves on the Wind number 2 by Zach Whedon and Jorge Yante. This continues to be really riveting. And what we've got going on here, basically, last issue was the aftermath of Serenity, and this issue is setting up what's going to be going on moving forward. I didn't want to mention this last issue or last review because I didn't want to spoil things, but we find out at the end of the first issue that that Zoe has had a kid, and her baby is now born, and she had some complications in her pregnancy, and she's in huge trouble now. She had to go find an Alliance hospital, and so I'd. In the middle of the Alliance trying to find Serenity, which is hugely problematic. And so this issue deals with all of that. And so she's in the hospital, and Mal wants to stay with her, but she's trying to get Mal to leave so that they don't get found. But ultimately, things are not working out great for everybody involved, and basically the Alliance is hanging on to Zoe and trying to trade her for Serenity and for Mal, and basically they're using her as leverage. And so River gets this really interesting idea of based on the stuff that happened in Serenity, well, because of all the tests and things that were done to me, I might still have more secrets, like Miranda, that we could barter with. So she tries to get her brother to put her in a coma in order to get those secrets out. And there's this huge risk, of course, of her becoming kind of nuts again. And she finally has become lucid, and she's from lack of a better term, normal now. And so she's risking going back to the way she was in order to help Mal, which I really, really like a lot. Well, in order to help Zoe, rather. So anyway, this continues to be, like I said, riveting. I love the art. I'm really happy with everything in this. I think it's really quite good. And I like the art. Okay, last issue, I thought that it was even stepped up a little bit more here. And also, Jane comes back, and we get to see why that is, and how his relationship with Mal has changed. And doesn't look like things between them are ever going to be the same again. It looks like he's double crossed him a bit. So anyway, still really recommending this. If you haven't read the first issue yet, go ahead and do that. And I didn't want to talk about this too horribly much because I know it's still brand new, and I want people to get a chance to try it. Next up, Ninja Turtles number 31. We're still in Northampton. We're still doing the aftermath of City Fall, and we have some really cool stuff here with Alapex, who is becoming more and more of a fully realized character, and I'm interested to see if she is going to continue to be an antagonistic character, or if she might ultimately end up becoming one of the Ninja Turtles' allies. There's a lot of hinting that that might happen. Her relationship with Raphael is really cool in this. I like that a lot. For a moment, I thought there might be a little bit of hinting that there could even maybe be a romance there, but I might be reading too much into that. I really wasn't sure about it by the end of their big exchange. They're sparring together a little bit, and it's heartwarming. It's a great moment. We get a kind of tense moment with Splinter and Leonardo here, which kind of turns into more of a bonding thing where Leonardo is finally starting to become a little bit more like his old self again. And the end of this is, with regards to that, is really kind of hits you in a place. And I liked all of that. Finally, we're dealing with the consequences of what Splinter did with Old Hob when he helped Old Hob go break into Stockgen and steal Mutagen. Splinter's not telling them everything, and I think by the end of this, he's still not quite telling them everything, and that's probably going to come back to haunt him. So all of that drama is really interesting. The kind of stuff that we've never really had with Splinter before. With we've got the relationship between April O'Neil and Casey Jones blossoming more. I think we spent a little bit too much time on the fact that she has a new hairstyle, but that's just me. She cut her hair short. Okay, fine. And then at the end of this, there's set up from last issue, there is a new mutate in town who has been sent by the Shredder to massacre the Turtles, and finally we start to get some action in this, and we're doing more than just healing from our wounds, but actually pushing the story forward. This continues to be fantastic. I love this issue. I love this book every time it comes out, and this is no exception. It's still fantastic. All right, next up, Ghostbusters number 13. This is exciting. This is really very exciting. Mass Hysteria number one, or Mass Hysteria part one, excuse me. I'm turning into Marvel, where everything's a number one, even if it's not a number one. Ghostbusters is finally doing a big arc, and a big event called Mass Hysteria, where a lot of the things that have been building in this book, all of these ghosts and specters constantly haunting and messing with the Ghostbusters, this is all kind of coming to a place, and it looks like there's a big, scary kind of ghost conspiracy kind of plan to come after the Ghostbusters. And it begins with bringing in a new character, or bringing in an old character from the movies that up to this point, according to Eric Burnham, they weren't allowed to use. I don't want to say who it is, because I think this is a really good jumping on point. If you've not been reading Ghostbusters, but you've been sort of intrigued by it, but it's just been going on too long, start here. Pretty good jumping on point, I think. And Burnham is even nice enough to, at the beginning of this, give you a breakdown of all of the major players, because it's not just the four Ghostbusters and Janine anymore. We've got a lot of other people involved now. We've got a lot of other people that are full-fledged Ghostbusters. And not too hard to keep track of or anything, but just this book has developed a lot of characters. Anyway, the old character that they bring back in is somebody from the first movie, somebody major, and really kind of exciting to see that character again. Things are just getting bigger in this book, finally, but still keeping it grounded, keeping it down to earth as much as you can with Ghostbusters, with character stuff and with life stuff. We've got Winston finally getting married to his girlfriend at the beginning of this, and I really like that they're going there. I like that they're letting these characters move on, and they don't have to live in a status in a single status quo forever. So anyway, this was really fun. I really enjoyed this. This is the best Ghostbusters issue I've read in a long time, and I really encourage everybody to get this, especially if you love Ghostbusters, but you haven't been sure about the comics, or you just never got around to it. Good place, I think, to start. I also wanted to mention that there is a picture that came out this week in memory of Harold Ramis that I think is a Schoening drawing. That's a really touching kind of sad picture of just the Ghostbusters uniform hanging up in a closet with Egon's name tag on it, and I thought it was really neat that they did a tribute like that, and I would expect that will probably show up in the next issue, and I wouldn't be surprised to see a couple other things probably about that. It was really kind of odd and kind of sad that Harold Ramis's death happened the same week this issue came out, before they had a chance to put anything in it about that, because this came out like a few days afterwards. And so next issue of Ghostbusters, I imagine there'll be a lot lot of Harold Ramis tribute stuff. Next up, Star Trek number 30. More of this really strange parallel lives thing. So if you missed last time, what's going on in Star Trek here? And this is just part two of a two-part story. We have the crew of the Enterprise duplicated, or it's not even so much a duplication so much as just coming from another parallel universe. We can't stop doing parallel universe stuff in Star Trek, and especially in the Star Trek comic, where everybody is the same, except that they're opposite genders. And in this issue, from the cliffhanger from last issue, we get to see Jane Kirk meet Jim Kirk. And yes, McCoy does at one point say, "Damn it, Jane," which is hilarious. But anyway, so they have to work together to in the kind of typical sort of parallel Earth story, figure out how to put themselves back into their respective universes. And in the meantime, in so doing, they briefly cross over with some other random parallel universes, which reminds me a whole lot of Parallels from Next Generation, where Worf did the same thing. He kept jumping into different dimensions, and then at the end of it, a lot of them started merging together, and he got to see different Enterprises from different places, including one with a bearded Captain Riker in a world where the Borg had kind of taken over everything. Well, you get some of that here. Not the Borg, but you get that kind of stuff here, and there are a couple of cameos that are kind of strange, especially because one of them is a TNG cameo, and I would have figured that it would have all happened like this would be TOS time period. It's weird that we see a TNG character in a TNG uniform, but I guess it was just an excuse to get to draw that person in one panel. I don't know. Anyway, that's about all that happens here. It's pretty much just for the novelty of getting to see the male versions, the male and female regular characters deal with their counterparts of the opposite gender and see how that would play out. It's like last issue, it's a little typical. I think I enjoyed this one a little bit more, but there was a lot of silly in this, but it's also kind of that sort of read, so it's all right. It's not brilliant, but it's not terrible. And again, it's kind of worth it for the novelty. It's sort of fun. Anyway, next up, we've got, I guess this is my last issue for today. Yes, indeed. We've got X-Files Conspiracy Transformers number 1. This is part 4 of 6 of the X-Files Conspiracy series. And I don't have a lot to say about this. I feel like the whole mystery plot in this is incredibly convoluted. I cannot keep up with it. It's all over the place. They are throwing every single random kind of sci-fi trope they can think of into this, and I can't keep up with it. Like there will be some new crazy random element thrown in every time we introduce a new property into this thing. So now we're dealing with Transformers, and so now there's some even more crazy things that come up that conveniently make sense to do with Transformers. And like I said, this isn't so much about, and unless we get to the end and the mystery, the way the mystery is solved is really compelling, but honestly, I kind of feel like this is really less about the mystery and more about, again, a novelty of just getting to see these characters get to play in these other realms. And yeah, they act like it's all in the same universe. It's hard to really it's hard to put something like Transformers in here, because it seems like more people would know about the Transformers. When they're dealing with when they're having these huge fights with Decepticons and things. But I don't read a lot of Transformers, so I don't know if they managed to keep most of that secluded. I mean, most of that secret where a lot of people don't know about it. They are dealing with properties where a lot of the time people do try to keep themselves concealed. I mean, after all, it is robots in disguise. I don't know what point in the current Transformers continuity they're at to where, like, to still, like, humans don't know about them, or are they really doing that? It makes a little more sense with Ninja Turtles. It was a little bit awkward with Ghostbusters, like I said, because it seems like in that universe it's just generally accepted that there are ghosts and that the Ghostbusters bust them, and so for the for the lone gunman to not believe it. It was a little bit strange. Anyway, I really don't have a lot to say about this particular issue. The art is a lot different from the first two, the first three, where it's really kind of dark and shady, and it makes a lot of sense for this. There's a part of me that almost wishes that the whole series was a little bit more like this art, actually. It's not my cup of tea. I like more polished things a lot of the time, but obviously, case-by-case basis, art should serve the story that you're telling, and we're in the X-Files universe more so than the rest of this, and so I'd like to see all these characters from different things drawn a little bit more like if they were in an X-Files episode. That's what you get with this. You get Transformers that look like they're kind of drawn in an X-Files episode. The humor is great here, though. It's kind of fun to hear Bumblebee and Optimus Prime bantering with the lone gunman. We get another cameo from Mulder in this, and when he popped up in the Ninja Turtles issue, it kind of felt like, oh cool, Mulder's here for a second. And then here, it was almost as if they wanted me to forget that they'd done it before. It was like, oh cool, Mulder's here for a minute. And I almost wish they'd done it every issue, where like they just keep consulting with Mulder for things, because both times, it kind of felt like a double beat. But anyway, not bad or anything. It's just, I'm not wholly sold on the story. I kind of feel like this is just an excuse to get to see these characters play in the same realm together. Is it worth it? Yeah, kind of. It's pretty fun. So anyway, let me go ahead now and go to Book of the Week, and I gotta figure out what my favorite issue is for this week. I really enjoyed everything I read this week. I had some complaints here and there, but this is a really, really good week, just like last week. And wow. There's too much to choose from. What was my favorite issue this week? I think I'm gonna go with, and it's not just because it's an indie book and I'm trying to look and I'm trying to look different. But I really liked Pariah. I thought that this was a really good start to a pretty sophisticated science fiction story, and I'm looking forward to seeing more from that. Cover of the week has got to be Ghostbusters. You've got these tentacles going around the Ghostbusters firehouse. I love that. I think it's a really, really cool cover. This is probably one of my favorite covers so far from the Ghostbusters series. And now, let's go over to Superhero Enthusiast. Yeah, I know, I had 13 books. He's got a bunch more. This was quite the week. We're gonna go over to Superhero Enthusiast and find out about some books that Captain Logan didn't read.
Hello, Geek Solutionaries. I am Alex, Superhero Enthusiast, once again here with BCLDR, Books Captain Logan Doesn't Read. And I got a lot of books this week, so I'm just going to jump right into it. The first one was a digital first from DC, and that was Adventures of Superman, number 44. Now, I missed 43 in here somewhere, but I didn't really miss anything. This is a story we've seen 100 million times before. It's giant robot comes from space and attacks Metropolis. Superman counterattacks. Robot says, hey, I'm actually from Krypton, and your dad Jor-El created me. And Superman's like, what? And that's basically where this issue, number 44, picks up. They fight because the robot's been programmed by aliens to be evil, because that's what happens to robots in space. If you're a robot, don't ever go out into space. It's very dangerous. As such, you know, I don't want to recommend this because, like I said, we've seen this 100 million times before, but the art is really the selling point in this. It's Doc Shaner doing it. I'm not too familiar with his comic work, but basically, if you search for any DC superhero on DeviantArt, you will see something by him pop up. So I'm familiar with him through that, and he has this beautiful classic retro style. And this one is worth it just to see Superman. Like, this brought me back to being like 4 or 5 years old, because this is what Superman looks like to me. He's got the kind of squared off trunks, he's got the wide boat neck, he's got the cape that kind of is almost frumpy in how it comes out. The cape has the S shield, the golden S on the back, but the negative space of the S shield isn't painted yellow. I think that originally came about because there's some crappy coloring back in the day, and they just kind of ran with it. But it looks so much better if there's red in there instead, and that's how it's done here. This is like, in my head, the platonic ideal form of what Superman looks like. So it's worth it just for that if you really want to see Classic Superman make an appearance, and you know, you're like me, you're not a fan of the New 52 suit. So, story poor, art great. I feel like I'm saying that a lot with this book. I kind of wish that they would get their crap together and, you know, get a really good writer and a really good artist and throw them together and have this not just be a showcase for just talented artists. And you have some good writers in there too. I mean, I guess they tried with the Max Landis thing, but when I reviewed that, that didn't really work out. It was just too, I guess, pretentious and overly philosophical when it didn't need to be. So I don't know. I want more. I want better. I want better stories in this. And this story especially, not just because we've seen it so many times before. It's dragged out. This is part of a, I guess, a 3-issue one, and this the cliffhanger. And this is obviously like all of these stories, the robots or the evil aliens who program the robot are coming to Earth, and then Superman and the robot have to team up. Yeah, we've all heard this story before. It doesn't need to be 3 issues. I mean, yeah, it's a 3-act structure, but it doesn't need to be 3 issues. You could probably do it in one, maybe two. So I don't know. If you like classic Superman art, check this one out. If not, you know, give it a pass. My other book from DC was another digital first, and that was Justice League Beyond number 14. Holy crap, this is a good book. I really, really like this. Like I said last time, Justice League fighting Brainiac, who has taken over the entire world, who is the world. And they're combining all their different powers and abilities and technologies together to try and fight him. And basically, they're making their last stand on Paradise Island, you know, Themyscira, home of the Amazons. And this is just brilliant, what's being done here. Basically, their whole plan to finally take out Brainiac is they make a computer virus. So they've got Max Gibson from Batman Beyond working with Clarion, the witch boy who has magic, so they're making like a magical computer virus because that helps fight Brainiac. But their problem is he's a 12th level intellect. How is he not going to be able to defeat this virus? I mean, I'm sure he's got like Norton 6000 working in there. So basically, their solution is to get Micron, who's basically the futuristic version of the Atom. To shrink down the Flash, who is obviously super, super, super fast, and can run faster than Brainiac can think. And there's some, I guess, you know, vacillation over whether or not they should even attempt, because they could kill Flash. Because I guess in the past, Ray Palmer was never able to shrink anything for longer than an hour and not have it just explode. Basically, you know, Flash is a hero, so she's like, well, you know, I'm a hero. A previous Flash made a huge sacrifice once upon a time. I'm sure I can do the same thing. Basically, that's where this one leaves off, and Brainiac's having some trouble. I think there's just one more in this little arc, but it's totally worth going back just a few issues to read this whole one. The story's freaking fantastic. Highly recommend it. I'm going to jump over to Image Comics actually for one of my favorite books on my pull list by Jonathan Hickman, and that's The Manhattan Projects, number 18. So, if you're not familiar with The Manhattan Projects, basically the whole backstory is the Manhattan Project was just a front for all these really cool scientists to do all these crazy, crazy super science projects behind the scenes. And this book has basically moved forward with history. The cast is all famous scientists, people that you'll recognize from history: Einstein, Feynman, von Braun, Daglian, all these different people, Oppenheimer. And they're all like amped up, really crazy versions of themselves. So von Braun is like a cyborg. Einstein is not actually our Einstein. He's the Einstein from, I guess, a different universe, and he was trying to build a wormhole machine. And basically, he went and visited another universe and met the other Einstein, and that Einstein basically conked him over the head and you know, said, "Hey, I'm gonna, you know, go back to your universe and replace you where I get all the glory because I haven't been able to figure this thing out." So basically, the Einstein that's in our universe is the Einstein who did invent it, but he can't remember how to get it to work again because he's a huge, huge alcoholic, and thus has some memory issues. Feynman is kind of just regular Feynman, but I mean, Feynman in real life was crazy, so and very extroverted, so he's a lot of fun. Oppenheimer is like a schizophrenic cannibal. He eats people and then they like live on in his head. So humanity basically met aliens for the first time, and Oppenheimer just killed their leader and ate him, and so they have all of their information. And basically, the whole plot that's been going on is it's been revealed that the Cold War is just made up. Scientists on both sides of it are working together, and they're creating this false conflict to drive military spending to fund all their science projects. So it's just a big scheme by the scientists to get funding for, as Wernher von Braun calls it, the cause. And that science. And basically, there's been some splits within the team, and Oppenheimer's not really with them. He's against them now, and he's the team has been working with General Groves, and Oppenheimer's hooked up with Westmoreland, who is crazy, and in this super, super, super crazy, he has like a necklace of ears that he cuts off of people that he's killed. Because Vietnam is going on right now in the comic. And basically, Einstein and Feynman have been traveling around the universe because they did eventually get the wormhole thing to work. And they built this giant, like, super alien thing. And most of this issue is just the super alien fighting Westmoreland. And it's one of the funniest things I possibly ever read. The alien talks like the dude from The Big Lebowski. So he's like, hey, man, like, I don't think we're going to be able to communicate, so we're going to have to fight. It's just the funniest, craziest thing. And basically, the team is split, and I'm curious to see where this goes, because some really big stuff happens at the end of it. And also FDR is in this, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. He did not die. He was uploaded to a computer, so he's an artificially intelligent thing who is very angry all the time. So he's kind of a recurring character in this, and there's some stuff that goes on at the end with him. I'm basically rambling now, but this book is just so totally awesome. You should totally check it out. I don't know for new readers what the best jumping on point would be. I'm kind of inclined to just say you sort of have to go back to the beginning and read it. I mean, it's very, very good, but it's, you know, not everybody's willing to go read, you know, over a year's worth of issues. But I totally love this book. This is one of my favorite things. Hickman always works really well with a gigantic cast of characters, and that's what this book has. This is one of the best things that Image is producing right now. And this is why, you know, creator-owned comics are really great. And making the whole comic scene right now the amazing thing that it is. I'm gonna head on over to Marvel with a lot of books, it seems, on my list here that I'm looking at. The first one was Fantastic Four number one. I'm not really a huge fan of James Robinson. He jumped ship from DC. He was doing the Earth 2 book, which I was reading, but, you know, as I said in my review of that, it's not really well written. And the whole premise for this upcoming story arc is basically, I guess, the death of the Fantastic Four. Not the literal death, but the breaking up of the team. And after the run that we just had that was all about family and coming together and stuff, I guess it's natural that this is going to be the next story, but I don't really have any interest in this. The way they're setting it up is pretty typical. I can kind of predict how it's going to go. I'm not even sure I need to read it. I'm just going to say maybe give this one a pass, go reread some Hickman Fantastic Four or the previous arc that just happened with Matt Fraction and the two, I guess, dueling books of Fantastic Four and FF, both of which were really fantastic and told two sides of the same story. The new costumes of the Fantastic Four in this are ghastly. They're red and black. It just doesn't work with the team at all. The art is pretty decent. So it's nice to look at, I guess, but this, I don't know, I just don't care about this story, so I don't think this is going to be a book that I'm going to continue to be picking up, but it was worth it just to check out. I got, like I said, I got some cool art to look at. There's some really nice splash pages in this, but not what I want to read. My next book from Marvel was Hawkeye number 15, and technically I read 15 and 16 this week. 16 shipped before 15. They did a total 90s Spawn thing there. Because I guess 16 was just ready first, and that doesn't normally make sense, because you'd think, like, well, wouldn't the artist do 15 before 16? But there's multiple ones working on this, because basically what's happened is Hawkeye in the title doesn't just refer to Clint Barton, it also refers to Kate Bishop, because she's Hawkeye too. And basically she's gone off to the West Coast, and it seems like they're going to alternate issues with this, one that focuses on Clint, one that focuses on Kate. And that's really a smart way to do it, since this book has had some shipping issues already. I guess, you know, having two artists means that they can better keep on schedule, hopefully. But we'll see. This whole mix up wasn't, I guess, indicative of that. But hopefully going forward they'll get that in order. 16 focused on Kate Bishop. I'll just say kind of briefly, she meets like this sort of pseudo Beach Boys guy, like he's like Brian Wilson, and as such there are all kinds of really great 60s references to it. She's on the West Coast, like I guess Daredevil's gonna be now, and Frank Castle the Punisher is now. Everybody's moving to the West Coast. I don't know what it is, but I'm really digging this kind of bright surfer vibe in books. She basically goes around, solves mysteries, and does Hawkeye stuff, and something's building up over there. So 16 was really good. I didn't need to hold out waiting for it, because like I said, they are doing the dueling thing. They're doing Clint's story, then Kate's story, and back and forth. But Clint's this week, number 15, holy crap. It's a really interesting contrast compared to the West Coast stuff, because it's very, very New York and somewhat bleaker. And just in terms of even the color palette, it's darker. The crazy clown guy, painted doll sort of dude, who killed Grills, is involved with the Tracksuit Mafia guys. The bro, come on, bro. We find Clint in this issue literally with his pants down. It's revealed in this what's going on and how those two bad guys who we weren't totally sure were related are working together, and what the whole, I guess, dealio is here, and why this building that Hawkeye lives in is so important. And that is, it's New York, it's old, and people want to redevelop it and build, you know, fancy condo things. Ain't that the way? And basically that's why I guess this whole story has been centered around Hawkeye in this building, and everything kind of makes sense now. And but there is a big reveal at the end of this. It's a very cartoony sort of a style, but like the most realistic you can make a cartoon, if that makes sense. The blood and stuff both fits with that and is in contrast to that. I don't want to say it's graphic. There is obviously blood in here and stuff. I'll just kind of say that. I'm rambling, but there is big stuff happens at the end of this, and I'm not sure what's going to happen next. It's keeping me at the edge of my seat. I'm really enjoying this book. Hawkeye is widely considered to be one of the best things that's being, you know, published at the big two these days, and rightfully so. Definitely. If you're reading this book, check out number 15. My next one was Indestructible Hulk number 19. This is still an Inhumanity tie-in. There's been some stuff going on with Bruce Banner's team. One of them, I guess at the end of the last issue, found out he was one of these new Inhumans, and he was in one of the fancy cocoon things, and changes into a monster, and not really much happens in this issue. Hulk and the guy fight. There's some interesting stuff, because somebody on Hulk's team has a disease and she's dying, and it's incurable, and she wanted to be the one who, you know, was an Inhuman, that way, you know, she could have survived. And her working with Hulk is sort of her quasi-suicide attempt, because, you know, she thinks probably sooner or later something is gonna, you know, happen that's bad, and Banner will change, and probably the Hulk will kill her, which is kind of really interesting, and I really like what Wade's been doing with these characters. But yeah, not much happens in this. It's basically Hulk fights the monster, and we see there's some type of organization that is trying to... they're doing the whole bad scientist thing. Not mad scientist, just bad scientist. And they're trying to, I guess, patent or get copyright on the material that the inhuman cocoons are made out of, so that they can then have legal rights to own the person who comes out of it. And they have this cool technology where basically, like, they can just turn walls into teleportation portals. And it leads to something that is totally awesome and makes sense at the end of this. I won't spoil what it is, but it's just so crazy and hilarious and comic book. I literally LOL'd. It's just sort of silly, but, like, in a good way. And, yeah, like I said, not much happens in this, so I'm just kind of saying the same thing over and over again. But there are a bunch of different artists on this one, and it kind of shows. I'm really still hating the lettering on this book. The way that they do the monologue boxes, it's like a tech thing, and the font is kind of hard to read, and the way that it's set up is all curvy, and it's the kind of thing that was, like, in vogue for depictions of tech, like, maybe 5 years ago, but it's just, like, looks really dated now, and I don't know why they're doing that. They need to get a new letterist on this. I know that's just a minor thing, but lettering and typography are something I'm a bit of a geek for, but they do so much to make books easily readable or not easily readable. So it's something that, you know, you need to pay attention to. The devil's in the details, as they say. But I'm not sure where to recommend, you know, if you haven't been reading The Indestructible Hulk, to pick it up. You know, maybe at the start of this inhumanity stuff, or just wait a couple issues for it to, I guess, turn over, because this is going to be relaunched as just Hulk. So we'll kind of see what happens there. I don't know. This issue was okay. I really like Mark Waid. I really like this book, but this just was not really that stellar of an issue. It's just sort of felt like filler to me. Speaking of Mark Waid, though, I'm going to jump over to a digital first or only digital Infinite comic thing from Marvel. I haven't read any of these, but Mark Waid, I guess, has been really pioneering this whole, I don't want to say medium, because I guess digital comics is the medium, but this is a type of digital comic. And holy crap. I really like digital comics. I read digital. I think there's great potential for the medium. Mark Waid has totally been pushing it, I guess, and this is indicative of that, because this is crazy stuff. I'll just show on screen here some of the cool things that you can do with this format. But basically, they're filling in the gaps, I guess, between Daredevil moving from New York to San Francisco, and this is just really well written. Like, I didn't expect them to do this. I didn't even know this was coming out till Wednesday when I picked it up. But it basically fills in the story, and it's called Road Warrior for a reason, in that he's traveling across country. We see some really interesting character stuff, and if you haven't been reading Daredevil, this actually isn't that tough of a book just to pick up and read, since they sort of explain who people are, and Mark Waid's really, really good at that, at, you know, the first issue, and you know, saying everything that needs to be said for a new reader, but also not feeling it, making it feel like it's a rehash if you have been reading. Yeah, basically, Daredevil's traveling across country, and he notices something really weird. There's a guy who doesn't have a heartbeat, and so he goes to check it out and gets involved in some crazy stuff that's happening. Guy just, like, bursts through a wall like Kool-Aid Man and runs away. He fights, I guess, like a Minotaur dude. I'm not too familiar with the character. I guess he's a pretty obscure guy in the Marvel Universe, from what I can tell from Marvel's Wikipedia thing. Yeah, this is, I don't know what to say. Like, this is just really awesome. Totally read it. Even if the story weren't good, I'd just say, like, check this out for to see the possibilities of what digital comics can offer. So much cool stuff is done to communicate things to the reader. And the thing that I like about this Infinite Comics format is you can, the reader is sort of in control of the pace of the story. Whereas, with a movie, that's totally up to editing. With a regular comic, it's, up to the paneler. But this is, you can kind of control it yourself. And I think that's really cool and makes it more interactive. So this is a lot of fun. Daredevil Rogue Warrior number one. Definitely check it out. Holy crap. But that does it for me though. This was a overall a pretty good week. There were some stinkers, I guess, in there, but some very shocking books, some very innovative books, and some very funny books, some just really, really fun and awesome and cool books. Overall, very, very good. I'm Alex, superhero enthusiast. Back to you, Captain Logan.
Thanks a lot, enthusiast. Really appreciate it as always. And everybody else, thanks so much for watching. We always really appreciate you tuning in and really hope that I could give you some advice about stuff to read this week. Sorry this came out so late. I'm going to try to start getting these out more like on Fridays. And this was just a busy week for me and a lot of books to get through. So anyway, if you're ever in the Kansas City area, as always, be sure to check out Elite Comics in Overland Park, Kansas. And if you ever want to send me anything to review on the vault, you can always send me stuff to our P.O. Box. That's Geekvolution, P.O. Box 14183, Lenexa, Kansas 66285. I'm Captain Logan. It was great getting to hang out with you for a while talking about comic books, and we'll do it again next week. Happy reading.